This is Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Thank you so much for joining us. Today we have the great pleasure of welcoming the great Cuban-American soprano, Lisette Oropesa.
So good to have you.
Thank you so much for having me tonight.
You just arrived here in New York a couple days ago.
Yes.
And you are singing. How many roles have you sung at the Met? Do you count?
Let me count.
You can count
my
out loud.
My first Idomeneo, I sang a Cretan. That was my debut. I sang in Manolasco, I sang one of the madrigal singers. In Suor Angelica, I sang a lay sister. I sang then Susanna, Gilda, Nanetta, Sophie. Is that all, Stephen? Dufairy. Oh, yeah, Dufairy. In Hansel and Gretel, which is the opera that I'm rehearsing now. So that's eight roles
Sophie
going on.
Sophie as in Werther.
Sophie and Werther, correct.
Okay. So that's, did you get up to eight or nine?
Seven going on eight. I think, no, that's eight, right? Eight roles.
That's quite a bit. Is it, do you call it your home theater? Is it?
Are I
you,
do.
Because you also went through the Young Artist Program here.
Yeah, I went through the Young Artist Program here from 2005 to 2008. And because it was my first professional experience, you know, as a student and then also as a professional singer outside of the program, I feel very much at home at the Metropolitan Opera.
How did you start?
Well, my mom was a singer, mm-hmm. and so as a small child, I grew up listening to her practice all the time, and she had a very similar voice to mine, so I would imitate her all the time, just most of the time making fun of her, you know, making operatic sounds all the time. I was in the church choir, and I kind of grew up with music all the time. My whole family actually sings very beautifully, so my sisters and I would harmonize in the car, and so we kind of developed our musical gifts naturally that way. And I grew up playing the flute because I wanted to do something different. I wanted to play an instrument, and it was the one that I thought was the most beautiful. So I devoted many years to studying the flute, and when I finished high school, I had still been singing a lot, just kind of on the side for fun, in church, you know, pop. And my mom said to me, you know, I really think you should consider auditioning for the voice faculty at the university, which was Louisiana State University. You should consider auditioning for them and see what they tell you. Because I have a feeling, Lisette, that you might be very at home on the stage and that you might really like performing opera. Oh, Mom, that's your thing. You know, I don't want, well, all right, I'll do it to please you. So I went in and I sang for them. And this aria I sang was O Mio Babbino Caro from Gianni Schicchi, which is a very famous aria. But my mom sang it all the time. So I just felt like I knew it. And the voice teacher at the time had actually taught my mom when she was a grad student there. And he said, oh yes, you have to sing. You absolutely must sing. And I insist that you join the voice program. And so I was a little torn because I had been spending all these years practicing an instrument, really working hard to be told that my natural talent that I wasn't spending as many hours nurturing and cultivating was better than my flute talent, which I had been really working hard on. So I was a little stubborn at first, and the whole first semester I did both flute and voice. And eventually they sat me down and they said, now you have to pick one, because in this university we can't offer you two performance degrees in music, and you really are a far more gifted singer than a flutist. And I took that to heart and I let go of the flute. Now, I'm still sad about it. You know, I miss it all the time. But I feel like if I hadn't trained as an instrumentalist first, I don't think I'd be half the singer that I actually feel like I have become, because your musical training is completely different as an instrumentalist when you're developing than it is as a singer. So I feel very much grateful that I had all those years to devote to the flute. And now, I mean, now I'm just completely devoted to singing. I'm in love with singing. Everything about opera, about performing is a dream to me, and I feel like, wow, it's like a great big Easter egg for me.
At what point did you feel, okay, this is it,
as in, this is what I want to do?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Probably after the first year that I completely let go of the flute. So my freshman year of college, I was still push and pull. And I was getting so much positive encouragement and positive feedback from my voice teachers, from my choir director, from the opera directors, you know, that singing was it for me. And as I started exploring, you know, I'm bilingual because my family's from Cuba. So I already speak two languages. And as I started exploring Italian, French, which I grew up studying because we live in Louisiana, where we study French in school. So I already, then I was like, oh wow, Italian, German. And I love languages. Because I'm bilingual, I think I have a little bit of a knack.
Sure.
So I started going, wow, you know, it was just the kinds of things that I love to learn about that I never had in a flute. Because when you play an instrument, you don't have text. You have to learn to express the music without text there and make the colors come out in the instrument. And now I had text to play with and drama and characters to build. And then it was like, this is theater. Oh my God, where has this been my whole life? I mean, you know, when you're an instrumentalist in the pit, it's not the theatrical experience of bringing a piece into your body and a character into your body. So then it was just like, it was like a Pandora's box, but in a great way. The first time I started singing opera, and my first role at LSU was Rosina in The Barber of Seville. And that was it. I was hooked after that.
Your mother must have been ecstatic about this.
Oh my God. She's the most wonderfully supportive parent that a singer could ask for. You know, I know a lot of singers come from musical families, and they understand that their families understand what they're doing. But a lot of singers don't come from musical families. And when they try to explain to their parents, oh, I'm singing at the Met, Mom, and their parents maybe at some point even tried to discourage them from studying music because they thought it would never pay or something.
Right.
My story is completely the opposite. My mother loved it. Got it, understood it, encouraged it. He told me that it was, you know, a gift, and it was the kind of thing that it was, you know, that it was just my destiny. I mean, she always believed in that, especially because she kind of gave up her dreams to raise us, me and my sisters.
So in other words, her dream is coming true.
Her dream. Yeah, she even says to me to this day, Lisette, I don't feel in any way that, oh, it should have been me. She said, I'm twice as happy that it's you, my child, having this glory and this magnificent, you know, living the dream, really, because it's you. It makes me even more happy. So it makes, I feel like my mom, in that sense, is a complete saint, because I've never felt any kind of resentment or why wasn't love. Never. The complete contrary. And I'm so fortunate to have that.
When she's in the audience, she probably sings every note with you.
I'm telling you. I always think that she's my toughest critic, but in reality, it's only because she knows my voice the best. And it's not that she criticizes my singing. In fact, it's usually the opposite. Because whenever she hears me now, because now I live, you know, and I'm traveling all over, and so she doesn't get to hear me every day like she used to when I was a kid at home, or even when I was in college, my mom used to hear me all the time. Now she hears me once every few months, or once a year even sometimes, live. And she'll, Lisette, your voice is, you know, taking on this character, and it's taking on that, and you've grown so much in this role. And now she's seen me do Gilda, you know, 3 or 4 times. Oh, I love how now you're doing this differently, and now you're doing that differently. So she can, she knows every little nuance. And if she thinks that something isn't right, she will tell me. But she says it to me in a way that's loving and nurturing, and it's never in a way of being a harsh critic that would make me feel terrible. But when she's in the audience, I'm always really nervous, honestly, because I know she knows. Mm. She knows.
Was she ever your voice teacher?
Technically, I would say no. We never sat down and had, here's some repertoire, let's do some scales, let's study formally this instrument, the way that I had flute lessons. My mom is a music teacher, and we always sang all the time. And sometimes after she stopped singing classical music and she began, education, we didn't formally sit down and ever look at any opera or roles like that. But she still sang beautifully, and so we would sing duets and stuff together at weddings and, you know, funerals and church services. And so we would sing pieces like Panis Angelicus, for example, or Ave Maria or something like that. And so we did study some pieces that are traditional classical pieces. And so in that realm, in that aspect, yes, she would say, okay, here's where we're going to breathe, you know, here's where we're going to do this phrase, here's where we're going to crescendo, blah, blah, blah. And so because she was so gifted, my mother is the best singer in the universe, I'm positive. It was just so great to get that in my ear all the time. So I always kind of picked up everything that she was doing, and because I always was just, I'm an imitator. I imitate what I hear. In fact, if I hear a recording of a certain singer, any singer, I pick up little nuances of what they're doing. And then if I would take it to my voice teacher later in college, they would say, you've been listening to so-and-so, haven't you? Because I would just have an imitative process, I suppose. Which is a good thing and a bad thing, because you don't always want to imitate things that aren't natural for you or correct for you. So I think it, lucky me, I had an incredibly pristine example of music of singing to follow.
When you finished school, were you just say, okay, I'm going to be a great singer, or you worry about it?
Well, it all kind of happened very suddenly because I was still an undergrad and I was doing competitions and stuff in Louisiana. Now, these are competitions that are regional to that area. In New York, there are far more vocal competitions available. But I wasn't, it wasn't a conservatory or anything like that. It was just a university. And so the only competitions that I had really done were like Nats and a few regional things. And then I did the Met competition because we did little district auditions right there in New Orleans. And I was 21 and I thought, oh, great, I'm finally old enough to try out and I'm going to just, everybody does it, you'll see what we do. And so my voice teacher, now he had taught my mom, he had taught me, and he said to me, he said, now, Lisette, you're going to do the Met competition. You're going to do really well. You're probably going to win. And I believe you're going to be invited into the Met Young Artist Program. This is what he told me. And I said,
such confidence.
Yeah. So he had incredible confidence in me. And he kind of said it to me kind of smiling like, this is what's going to happen to you in a kind of a nice half joking, half not joking way. And I said, oh, that's so funny, Professor. Thank you very much for the confidence. I'm going to do my best, but no way. That's not going to happen. And that's exactly what happened. I did the competition. I kept advancing further and further, did the semifinals, and then did the finals, won one of the main prizes. And then I had to decide, because I was getting ready to graduate my undergrad, and I had applied at some graduate schools. I was looking at IU. I was looking at Curtis. I was looking at AVA. And then it was like, I had to decide whether I wanted to continue on graduate study or if I was invited in the Met program, which I was, to choose the Met program. And I actually said to the Met, I said, well, I'm not really sure what I should do, to be honest. Is it all right if I take a few days and think about it to decide? Because when they invited me, I suppose they were expecting like a yes right then or a no right then. And so I went back to my voice teacher and I said, Professor Grayson, I was invited into the Met program. What should I do? And he said, what kind of stupid question is that? You should go into the Met program. Like, absolutely. Why would you do anything else? I said, well, I don't know. Should I maybe do grad school for a couple more years? And
you thought you were too young?
Well, I thought because, I don't know, somehow my university schooling made me think you needed a master's degree to really learn, to really get into the deeper layers of operatic training. I didn't think my age at that time, in my naivete, I didn't think my age, 21, was the problem. I thought that I hadn't learned enough. I hadn't had enough experience. I hadn't had enough just knowledge about the repertoire and the style and things like that. And I thought, and he said, but Lisette, that's the best place to go to grad school, sure, is the Met. That's, he's right, like, you will go from, level 0 to 100 in just a few years. And I never processed how that would feel as a young person at that age. Because when I came into the program, I was the youngest one in our group. And I only went in with two other singers who were invited that year. And then as I started doing it, and working there and going every day, I started seeing, wow, I am the youngest one here. I am the greenest one here. I had sung roles at LSU, and I had studied language at LSU, and I was very devoted to music, and I was always, I never partied at school. I was extremely studious, serious, but I literally was straight out of university into this young artist program. So I still had that university mindset. But I always felt a little bit, because there were other kids in the program who knew every opera singer, every recording that was ever made, every role so-and-so ever sang, every single repertoire, any role, name it. And there were people who just knew far more than I. And I felt like, wow, I have so much to learn. So I always felt like a student. But even when I went into the Young Artist Program at the Met, I had incredible guidance from people who believed in me very, very much. And that was the thing that made me not go home and want to quit. Because young artist programs, at, I think, many, many houses are extremely, they're hard. Because they work the singers very, very hard. You're rehearsing a lot. You're getting a ton of coachings, things from people left and right. You're getting a ton of role study. You're singing probably 2 or 3 times as much as you ever did when you were in school. You're singing every day, all day. You're attending rehearsals. You have to go to every single final dress at the Met and see every production. And you're seeing the major leagues. I mean, you're not seeing the workings of a house that is still dealing with issues. You're seeing the workings of a house in that is like such a well-oiled machine. So you're just, it's overwhelming. It's like getting on a roller coaster and just all of a sudden it just goes 90 miles an hour, and that's what it feels like. Yeah, you feel overwhelmed sometimes, but I never ever felt like I wanted to quit. I did in college a couple of times. In college, there were a couple of times when I felt like, I don't know if I can do this. Sometimes there's university politics that go around. Sometimes there's jealousy in university that goes around. Sometimes there's gossip and things like that. I mean, there's petty things. There are petty things in every business. But in university, in a music school, they're really, really, because you're tight. You're in this tight-knit community, and you only see and know each other, and you're at that age where you're discovering your voice, and you're discovering your talent, and you know who studies with who, and who does what, and who sang what, and who knows this person, and who's dating so-and-so. And there's all this stuff that's very university mindset. And then you go to the Met, and you have a lot of things that are similar in a more grown-up way, because now you have people working and people earning their paychecks, and you have people with the stakes with kids at home and families to feed and years of experience, years of wonderful things, marvelous careers, sometimes years of disappointment, sometimes, you know, and so you have, it's like you, everyone is just so much more experienced in life, and you're this young, green, 22-year-old kid learning from these people and hearing their stories and feeling what they've been through and going, wow, that's going to happen to me probably one day.
Outside the Met and the program, weren't you overwhelmed about the idea of New York City and living here?
Oh, that too. Oh, Dennis. You know, I mean, I came from Baton Rouge. And Baton Rouge, Louisiana is a medium-sized city, I would say. And I had never, and it's also a very conservative city politically. And so having been raised in a mindset in an area and a time when conservatism and ideas related to conservatism were kind of prevalent amongst everybody there, except for the music school. The music school was a little safe space. But everywhere else outside of that, the idea of any kind of an artsy, free thinking, I dress how I want, self-expression, all that kind of thing did not exist. It's very football, it's very, and that's wonderful. I'm glad that I experienced many, many years of that in that kind of environment. But when I came to New York, it was the polar opposite, because there were people everywhere, people of all cultures, people of all languages, of all faiths, on the subway, and I hadn't even seen people sometimes that looked like that or spoke like that or dressed like that. And here I am, and I was like, whoa, I need to open. I mean, this is still when the internet was like young, I feel like, because I didn't even have a computer at my house. I was very traditionally brought up. And then I came to New York and I moved to Queens and I lived in this little basement apartment and I had this 60-minute commute into town. And I would sit on that train, and that train ride was fascinating to me because I could see New York coming in and out, and I fell in love. I was like, this is amazing. I love that I'm a Spanish person, because that was another thing. I'm Hispanic. And in Louisiana, there's a very small Hispanic community, if any, in Baton Rouge anyway, very small. And here I am in the subway, and there's people speaking Spanish everywhere. And I was like, oh, I'm gonna love it here. This is marvelous. Salsa dancing, salsa music, culture, the food I like to eat, the expressions I like to use, the fact that I talk with my hands or whatever, that's not weird anymore. That is like amazing. Everybody, oh, I'm gonna fit in here wonderfully. And I feel like New York is home, you know? So I feel, and I still feel that way. Even though I've been to many cities around the world, I still feel like now New York is my home.
So after 2 years, then what happened?
After 3 years, I got a manager, and I started singing, I still was singing smallish roles at the Met, a few, or even sometimes bigger roles at the Met, and then I started singing elsewhere in Europe. You know, Germany, I had a couple of engagements. In Spain, I had an engagement. And I started doing the European thing and started traveling overseas and experiencing other countries, which was another big eye-opener for me, because I had only ever been overseas on a very short European trip with the choir when I was in college. So I hadn't really seen a lot of the rest of the world. and how Europeans lived and what they really, what it was like to be in a city that, where everyone speaks a different language and you're the outsider having to communicate with someone else. And so I felt like, in a lot of ways, being bilingual, that was the first test of all my language work and my love for language is getting to kind of take over my brain for a while. Go into rehearsals and nobody speaks English. And going to rehearsals and having to not just communicate musical ideas, you know, but theatrical ideas with each other, you know. So it was, it started to become like, oh my God, this is great. I mean, every time I do another trip back and forth, I love seeing the differences in how people live in Europe, how people live in America, even around different parts of America. I mean, that's one of the, I think, the best things about the job outside of the theater, you know, is getting to see what people are like, how people express themselves, how they dress, how they carry themselves, you know, in other cultures, from other languages. And so you go, wow, you know, when I sing in that language, I'm going to remember this person, how they express themselves in that language, you know, because not everybody expresses themselves the way that I do, you know? So I feel like that's something I really like.
What was your first big break?
My first big break at the Met was when I was covering Susanna, and I went on and ended up singing five performances, and that was a very last-minute change in the
last
casting.
Last minute, like an hour,
like a day before final dress. We want you to sing the final dress tomorrow, and the first two performances was the first phone call I got, and I said okay, and I hadn't really rehearsed much because I was the second cover. And I ended up going on. So I hadn't had a lot of chances to really work. But the conductor heard me, and the conductor said, yes, this is, we'd like to put Lisette on stage. But because the lady that was singing was pregnant. And so it ended up not working out. And so I ended up going on. And I remember I was still learning the blocking during the overture. Like at final dress, the curtain was down, the overture's going on. And I was on stage learning the staging for the first act. And I was like panic. And all of a sudden the curtain opens and I'm sitting there and I'm just like, well, Susanna sings itself. So here we go. And the good thing about Susanna is she's a maid. And all she really, most everything she does is exactly what she says she's supposed to be doing. There's nothing illogical about the character. It's extremely clear. And because I had sung the role in college once before and I knew it so well, it was so ingrained. Once that music started, I was like, oh, I know what to do. I'm just going to do it. I'm just going to do exactly what Susanna always does because that's her. I feel like I knew the character. So I jumped in and I sang all five and I sang the first two and then they was like, okay, we'd love you to sing the rest of them. So I sang five performances and that was probably my first big break.
We have just enough time to hear a bit. We'll jump to the fourth act. Let's hear some aria in the fourth act.
Beautiful.
That is so beautiful.
Thank you so much.
That's a great way to end the first part of our conversation here. We'll be back. We're here today speaking with Lisette Oropesa on Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis.